morning, church. We're glad you're here in the house of the Lord this morning. We welcome all of you. We especially like to greet our guests, and I wondered if you considered yourself a guest, if you'd raise your hand. I know I met some right here. These are the Joneses, and they're from our community. We're thankful to have you worshiping with us today. Over there, I saw some others. Wave your arms. You're on. Well, they're a guest. Starting next Sunday, you won't be a guest anymore. They're joining next Sunday, so you won't have to raise your hand. Anyone else considered a guest here this morning? Right over here, we got some folks. We're glad to have you worshiping with us today. We welcome all of you. Anyone else? Don't want to leave anybody out. We're glad you're all here. We do have a registration pad in the pew. We do ask that you register your attendance and give us information. It's helpful to us. If you have a change in address or telephone number or email address, put it on there. If you're a guest with us and you'd like to receive our newsletter that comes out by email every Thursday, just give us your email address and we'll be glad to add you to that so that you can know what's going on in our church. We are receiving members next Sunday morning. We have, now three couples to join next Sunday. So if you're not yet a member, you'd like to become a member, shoot me an email. I'll be out of town this week, but I can respond to email. We'd love to welcome you next Sunday as well. I've been asked to remind everyone that tomorrow is the day, our day, for feeding the hungry at Hope Place from 8:30 to 11-ish, 11:30, I think. We have folks who go to do that once a month. We have a number of folks here. You can talk to those folks. They would love to have you join them. We provide labor for preparing the meals for the homeless in our community once a month. So that is our day for that. There's a children's ministry meeting after church today over in Bleakman Hall. If you're interested in being involved in children and youth and family ministries, our activities, if you enjoyed the bingo and chili night we had, that was from that committee. So if you'd like to be a part of that committee, you're always welcome to join right after church over in Bleakman Hall. We have Sunday school classes in this end of the property after church this morning. Next Sunday, we also have our peanut butter and jelly making sandwiches after church. This is also for the homeless. Plan to stay after church next Sunday over in Bleakman Hall for a little while and make peanut butter and jelly sandwiches for the homeless. Yard sale is coming up on the 18th. Hopefully you're collecting things or going through your garage and closets to make donations. Starting next Sunday, you can bring your yard sale donations or any morning up to the yard sale. If you'd like to sign up for volunteering, either the setup or the selling or the cleanup, there's on the congregational care credenza out there, you can volunteer to participate in the yard sale. And then also, we hope that we'll have people there to help clean up afterwards. Then, of course, come and buy everything back. But all the proceeds from our yard sale every year is divided between our women's and men's ministries here at the church. The children's home trip. The bus that we wanted to take to the children's home from First Methodist, the air conditioner is not working. And so we're not going to take the bus. We don't want to sweat. But we're going to carpool. So there's a sign-up sheet also on the congregational care credenza out there if you'd like to be a part of that, either drive or carpool. You can read about it in the bulletin. Please sign up. Let's see. Kids Care on the 10th, this Friday, if you'd like to help watch children, the children of the teachers across the street. We provide child care for them when they have a teacher duty day, and so they don't have to find child care for their children. So you can see Linda Neely back here. She can tell you all about that. Also, I was asked to remind you that next Saturday night, change your clocks. We're going to spring forward next week. And I believe that concludes our announcements. We're going to now ask Pastor Sharon to come and share briefly about our Nehemiah Action Assembly.
Good morning. Well, as you know, our church is a member of FAITH. That's a justice ministry organization. FAITH stands for Fighting Against Injustice Towards Harmony. And I just want to remind everyone that our annual Action Assembly will be Monday, March 27th. It starts at 6:30. This year, it will be held at Our Lady of Hope Catholic Church. That's on Clyde Morris down in Port Orange. We will be carpooling, meeting here at 5:30, and we hope that we will have a bus to use by then. Everybody is invited to attend. In fact, our goal is to have everybody that's here this morning to attend the Action Assembly. I hope that all of you will receive a personal invitation to attend with a reminder card, but if you don't get one, consider this your personal invitation to please come out and attend the Action Assembly. I'm just curious, how many already know that you're going to attend that night? Just raise your hands. Okay, next Sunday, I hope that would be many, many more hands going up. And I forgot to look at the choir. But yeah. I also just want to remind the members of our Justice Ministry Network that tomorrow night is our rally. This is for everybody is invited to come if you want, but it is especially for our network members. You know who you are. And we will meet here at 5:30 to go down to Coronado Community United Methodist Church in New Smyrna Beach. So network members, remember that tomorrow night, and everybody else, please put the action on your calendar Monday, March 27th. Thanks a lot. Thank you. we are to have those wonderful handbells. Will you please stand now for our call to worship? Praise the Lord, you angels, you mighty ones who carry out his plans, listening for each of his commands.
Yes,
praise the Lord, you armies of angels who serve him and do his will. Praise the Lord, everything he has created, everything in all his kingdom. Let all that I am praise the Lord. Please remain standing for our opening hymn, To God Be the Glory. Remain standing and join me in our affirmation of faith. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen.
do appreciate all the ways that you support this church and the ministries of this church that make a difference in our community and around the world. I want to remind you, I just saw a wonderful video from United Methodist Committee on Relief about the work that we've been doing in Ukraine and encouraging us to continue our support for Ukraine through the United Methodist Committee on Relief. You can go online to the conference website, or you just Google United Methodist Committee on Relief, and if you'd like to make a donation to continue the support that we give to those who are struggling through that tragedy. But there's so many different ways that you give and support the life of this church and the ministries that make a difference in our world. We thank you for that. Of course, everything that we present, give to God is a representation of our own lives and our devotion to Him. So let us stand and present ourselves to God through the presentation of our tithes and our offerings.
Our first scripture reading this morning comes from the 6th chapter of Matthew, continuing the Lord's Prayer. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Our second reading from the 11th chapter of the Revelation to John. The seventh angel sounded his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven which said, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Messiah, and he will reign forever and ever. And the 24 elders who were seated on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worshiped God, saying, we give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, the one who is and who was, because you have taken your great power and have begun to reign. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you for the gift of your word, and as we think on these things, open our hearts and minds to hear your word to us. Amen. A father was upset because his son was so biblically illiterate. You probably don't even know the Lord's Prayer, he said. Oh, yes, I do, the boy stammered. Oh, really? Then prove it. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. Surprised, his father replied, well, I'm sorry, son. I had no idea you knew it. Well, most of us aren't quite that biblically illiterate. But if we're honest, we have to admit we aren't much better than that boy and his father. We may know the words to the Lord's Prayer, but how many of us really know what the prayer means? That's what we're focusing on during this Lenten sermon series. What does the prayer that we repeat week in and week out really mean? Last Sunday, we looked at what it means to say that God is our Father. Today, we're going to look at the second phrase of the prayer, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Perhaps no other phrase in the Lord's Prayer is more central to the heart of Jesus' ministry than this one, because Jesus loved to talk about the kingdom. The Gospel of Matthew tells us that Jesus even began his ministry by preaching about the kingdom. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, we read, "From that time, Jesus began to preach his message, 'Repent of your sins, because the kingdom of heaven is near.'" All throughout his ministry, Jesus preached about this kingdom of God, especially when he told parables. Very often, the parables begin with the words, "The kingdom of God is like," and then it goes on to describe through a parable what the kingdom of God is like. And in the book of Acts, chapter 1, we read that even after his resurrection, Jesus continued to talk about the kingdom of God. In Acts chapter 1, verse 3, it reads that after his resurrection, Jesus appeared to the disciples over a period of 40 days and spoke about, you guessed it, the kingdom of God. Certainly, one cannot read the New Testament without coming to the conclusion that most of Jesus' ministry revolved around this theme of God's reign or God's kingdom. In fact, in the three Gospels, Jesus makes reference to the kingdom no less than 119 times. If the kingdom of God, or the kingdom of heaven, as Matthew likes to refer to it, was so important to Jesus, it behooves us as his disciples to try to understand what he's been talking about. When Jesus teaches us to pray, "Thy kingdom come," what does he mean? To learn the meaning of the kingdom of God is not as easy as it might at first sound. If you were to study the teachings of Jesus on the subject of the kingdom of God, you would find that Jesus referred to the reign of God in at least three different contexts. First of all, he spoke of the kingdom of God as having existed in the past. In the past. This seems strange to us because we're much more familiar with thinking of the kingdom of God as something that has already come, or will come in the future, is yet to come in the future. After all, when we pray the Lord's Prayer, don't we pray, "Thy kingdom come"? Yet Jesus tells us that the kingdom has always existed, although veiled from human eyes. That the kingdom can be glimpsed briefly in the lives of the great figures of ancient Israel, when the reign of God broke into our world and gave us a hint of God's intention for creation and for humanity. It's as if the kingdom of God exists in this parallel universe, an alternative reality that intersects with our dimension from time to time throughout history and at various occasions in our own lives. You've probably experienced those inbreakings of God in your life. There have always been these sightings of the kingdom by people who are attuned to the things of God, even long before Jesus came into the world. Now, how do we know that to be true? Because Jesus tells us as much in Matthew chapter 8, verses 10 and 11, when speaking about the faith of a Roman soldier, a Roman officer. This is what Jesus says, quote, "I tell you, I have never found anyone in Israel with faith like this. I assure you that many will come from the east and the west and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob at the feast in the kingdom of heaven." Jesus tells us that these Old Testament heroes of the faith are already present in the kingdom of God. Yes, Jesus believed that the reign of God has existed throughout history, but it goes back even much more farther than that. God has been on the throne from the very beginning. The scriptures make this clear as well. In Psalm 93, verse 3, this is what it says. Your throne was established long ago. You are from all eternity. In the story of the Garden of Eden, we learn that from the beginning of time, God reigned both in heaven and on earth. And Adam and Eve lived in God's paradise, a heaven on earth. But then we humans rejected God's sovereignty, and creation fell into the mire of sin and evil. Satan became the ruler of the earth so that God's undisputed reign was limited only to heaven, and God's kingdom has never been fully restored on earth since. But in his statement about the Roman soldiers' faith, Jesus was saying that there were a few shining moments in Israel's history when the kingdom of God broke through, like a candle shining in the darkness. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, Joshua, David, Deborah, Josiah, Ezra, the prophets. Times when it seemed that God's kingdom would break upon the scene once more in all its glory and that God's paradise would be restored on earth. But every time God's kingdom seemed on the verge of coming again on earth, the people of Israel rejected God's sovereignty, just as Adam and Eve had done before. And the world was plunged back into darkness once again. And that's the sad story of the Old Testament. Before the coming of Christ, most people lived their lives as if the kingdom of God didn't even exist. And when you stop to think about it, that also describes most people in our day as well. Most people are just oblivious to the kingdom of God. So, as we have seen, Jesus sometimes spoke of the kingdom in the past tense, a kingdom which has always existed in heaven, but which human sin had kept from coming on earth. He also speaks of the kingdom in future tense. Throughout history, people may have seen these glimpses of the kingdom and then looked forward to the day when God's reign will come in its fullness. It's true that God's reign has not yet come in all its glory, but over and over, Jesus promises that one day it will. On that glorious day, when it comes, God will be completely victorious over Satan and will reestablish his sovereignty over the earth. Then, as the prophets tell us, justice will roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Swords will be beaten into plowshares and spears into pruning hooks, and we will study war no more. John, in the Revelation, tells us it will be a time when there will be a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the holy city, this new Jerusalem, will come down out of heaven from God, and God will dwell with his people. A time when God will wipe away every tear from our eyes, for there will be no more reason to weep, for the old sinful order of things will have passed away. A time when God will make all things new. A paradise. The paradise of the kingdom of God that was lost in the Garden of Eden will be restored, and God's intention for creation and humanity will finally be fulfilled. It will be a day when those of us who hold our citizenship in the kingdom of heaven will be forced to live as aliens on earth no longer. That, my friends, is the day for which all followers of Jesus long and pray. It is the most urgent prayer of God's people. So much so that we find it recorded in the very final verses of the Bible. God's people earnestly pray, "Come, Lord Jesus." That's how the Bible ends, by the way. Come, Lord Jesus. Or, as Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, quote, "Then the end will come. Christ will overcome all spiritual rulers, authorities, and powers, and will hand over the kingdom to God the Father. For Christ must rule until God defeats all enemies and puts them under his feet. The last enemy to be defeated is death." But, Paul writes, "But when all things have been placed under Christ's rule, then he himself, the Son, will place himself under God, who placed all things under him, and God will rule completely over all." That is, over both heaven and earth. Friends, that is what we pray for each and every Sunday when we say, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." So we've seen that the kingdom of God can be thought of in both past and future tense. That the king has always has been, and at the same time, the kingdom will one day be. It exists already, but not yet. For believers, it's our reality as well as our hope. Does that sound like an enigma to you? How can both be true at the same time? Because Jesus also refers to God's kingdom in the present tense. Yes, the kingdom of God has always been, and it will one day be revealed in its fullness, Jesus tells us. But I think the most significant teaching of Jesus is that the kingdom of God is here and now, always present in our midst, if we will only open our eyes and our ears to perceive it. As we've already heard, the cornerstone of Jesus' ministry was this message about the kingdom of God being at hand. And it was at hand. Why? Because Jesus had come. From Luke 17, we read this. One day the Pharisees asked Jesus, "When will the kingdom of God come?" And Jesus replied, "The kingdom of God isn't ushered in with visible signs. You won't be able to say, 'Here it is,' or 'It's over there,' for the kingdom of God is among you." Now, your translation, if you look it up, may say "within you," but I think "among you" is a more accurate translation. The kingdom of God is among you and within you. In his teaching, Jesus was announcing that one of these rare moments in history when God's kingdom would break into the world once more was upon them. But this time, something was different. This time, God had sent his very own Son to accomplish two things. First, to offer humanity the opportunity to become citizens of God's kingdom. And two, to finally overcome the evil that has held the world in its grip. And not only did Jesus teach that the kingdom of God was upon them, he also acted out this reality. Whenever Jesus healed the sick or cast out demons, he was demonstrating that God's reign on earth was beginning. The light of God's power was banishing the dark forces of evil. The king had come, and he was beginning to reclaim his rightful place as the Lord of heaven and earth. But this didn't mean that the earth would suddenly become God's domain again. Satan still is loose in the world. There is still a struggle to be waged between the spiritual forces of evil. And that's where the church comes in. You see, it is God's plan that you and I should play a part in bringing God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. That's what it means to say we're the body of Christ in the world today, by the way. In Jesus, God challenges us to switch our loyalty, inviting us to change our citizenship, to renounce the kingdom of Satan, and declare our allegiance to the kingdom of God. Or as the gospel according to Star Wars movies, we are urged to come over from the dark side and join the force for good. In the early days of the church, those who converted to Christianity would often be baptized on Easter morning as part of an Easter vigil that lasted from sundown on Saturday night through sunrise on Easter morning. It's the origin of our Easter sunrise services, by the way. Near dawn, they would stand, the new believers would stand waist deep in the baptismal pool facing west, the direction of the gloomy darkness of night. And they would renounce Satan's claim on their lives. They would spit, literally spit in that direction as they renounced Satan. Then they would go under the water and come up out of the water facing east and the rising sun of new life and proclaim their faith in the risen Christ. You see, as Easter people, we are citizens of the kingdom of God. We hold our true citizenship in heaven, even while we must live as foreigners on earth. If you have ever traveled abroad, as you notice, we're going to be traveling abroad next year to Israel, little commercial. But if you've ever traveled abroad, you know what I'm talking about. You might cross the borders into a foreign country, but your citizenship doesn't change. Your passport still says you're a citizen of the United States of America or wherever you're from. And even if you live and work in a foreign country, your citizenship remains the same. When we renounce the kingdom of Satan and become citizens of the kingdom of God, it doesn't matter where we live, in heaven or on earth. Even if we must live in this fallen world for a time, our passport declares that we belong to God. That means that the kingdom of God, while not yet coming in its fullness on earth, can be a reality for us here and now, if we allow God to reign as king of our lives. In Jesus, the kingdom of God is a present reality for you and for me, provided we declare our loyalty to Him alone. As we've seen, the kingdom of God has existed all along, and will one day finally come in all its fullness. But the coming of the kingdom that matters for you and me is this present reality in your life and in my life. The kingdom of God has come and will come and is even now realized whenever and wherever we allow God to rule supreme in our life. We live in the kingdom of God when we make ourselves subjects of the King of Kings. In a few minutes, we will be experiencing one of those rare moments in time when you and I get a glimpse of the reality of the kingdom of God as we encounter the presence of Christ in sharing the bread and cup of Holy Communion. We do it every week. And as you come to the Lord's table this morning, you will have an opportunity to turn your back on the dark side, to declare your allegiance to the King, and to claim your citizenship in the kingdom of heaven. Then you can join the angels in heaven and all God's people on earth in singing the hymn of praise that we find recorded in the book of Revelation. Words which we're familiar because you've heard them. They've been set to music by Handel in his Messiah. The kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever, King of kings and Lord of lords. Or as Jesus taught us to pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. God, my desire is to build your kingdom and not my own, but I confess most of the time I live like that is not true. I spend so much of my day trying to build my kingdom, making myself instead of you the center of this life. Lord, I need your Spirit to remind me minute by minute that this life is not all about me, it's all about you. Your word says that the time is coming when every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and your kingdom will be made complete. In the end, that will be all that matters. Nothing I build for my own glory will be left. So I ask you to help me stop spending this life focusing on myself. Jesus, I want to see my daily life through the eyes of your kingdom. Help me to seek your kingdom in my heart, mind, and life. Hear the good news. In the New Living Translation of Matthew's Gospel, Jesus says this to us: seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are a forgiven people. Amen. Our hymn as we prepare for communion is a modern hymn. The kingdom of God is justice and joy. The kingdom of God. Thank you. Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We give thanks, Father, because you were God even before time began. You have seen every sunrise, every day begin since you first gave form to our home, this earth. You launched it into your universe, shaped its hills, and filled its seas. When space was ready, you brought life out of the waters, and in time made us in your image, male and female. Yet we were not content with such a paradise. We rebelled, putting our wills before yours. Even then, we found you boundless in love. Time after time, you reached out your hand to touch our lives with loving kindness. You led us from captivity to the land you promised. You made covenant to take us to be your people, to love and to cherish. And we took you as God and ruler, promising to forsake all others. You put your words on the lips of women and men. They spoke your words of law and grace, gave themselves in the struggle for justice, and fought us and taught us to sing your glory. We join with those who have lived and those now living in faith from sunrise to sunset, from south to north, as with one voice in the song of unending praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Full indeed are heaven and earth of your glory, holy Lord God. When time was ready, you, the creator of all that is, sent Christ to be a creature like us, the Word made flesh. Instead of a servant, you sent your own Son that he might be a servant of all. Christ alone, he who is closest to your heart, he made you known to us. Walking among us, Jesus the Christ performed great signs to reveal his glory. He spoke as one having authority, that we might trust your love and obey your law. When his hour had come, he drank the cup of suffering and accepted the baptism of death. Like a lamb, he was led away from the living, but as your son, he was raised from the grave. Having triumphed over death, he left our sight, and his spirit might fill our hearts as we await the completion of all things in him. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, the Lord Jesus took bread in his hands, lifted his eyes to heaven. He gave you thanks, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you." When the supper was finished, he took the cup. Again, he offered thanks to you, gave the cup to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we know anew the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ and look to that day when we shall feast in his eternal kingdom. With hearts raised in joy, we know anew Christ's life among us, his death because of us, his resurrection for us, and his ascension to glory. Join this memorial made by your priestly people, bound by earth and time, to the heavenly and timeless offering for us of Christ himself, our great high priest. As we join our voices with your saints down through the ages in proclaiming the mystery of faith. Dying, Christ destroyed our death. Rising, Christ restored our life. Christ will come again. Send, we pray, your Holy Spirit on us, gathered here out of love for you and on this offering. May your spirit make real the signs that through breaking bread and drinking wine together, we know the presence of Christ among us. By the Spirit, make us one with the goodness of Christ, as you made him one with our sinfulness, that we may be one with each other and one in service to all that you have created. We also pray today for those in special need of your love. Hear us as we name them. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your Holy Church, all your people and all your works glorify and honor you, Father, now and forever. Amen. And now let us pray the Lord's Prayer as translated in the Good News Translation. Our Father in heaven, may your holy name be honored. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the food we need. Forgive us the wrongdoings we've done. And forgive the wrongs that others have done to us. Do not bring us to hard testing, but keep us safe from the evil one. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours forever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of those whom you have fed with one heavenly food. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Would you stand as we sing our closing hymn? How many of y'all were ever sang out of the Cokesbury hymnal? Ah, we're going to sing a hymn out of the Cokesbury hymnal, so let's stand as we sing. Back memories. A Sunday school assembly. Anybody been to a Sunday school assembly where you sing those songs? Or is it just me? Anyway. You see this benediction. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in our hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.